Today I'm going to introduce you to 5 reasons why you should shoot in 60p. How is it hanging, fellow light hunters, tube grinders, content creators, guys, I really need help coming up with a new intro. So if you'd be so kind, just comment below and give me some ideas. I need something really unique, something you don't see a lot on other channels, something related to photography, vlogging, YouTubing, and perhaps a little less to like travel and adventure-y stuff. It's a hard task, I know. So I've had my Nikon for like almost 4 years now. This is the D3300. And back in the day, little did I know, it had an awesome feature, which is recording full HD videos in 60p. That is back in the day when very few cameras had the ability to shoot 60p, much less an entry-level camera. It's really an amazing feature. It's irreplaceable in my filmography and the videos I create, and I'm going to share a little bit with you why you should use this feature. This part of the vlog doesn't really have a purpose. I just have to distract you guys a little bit because I forgot to set the frame rate. And so, reason one is... Sometimes as a video producer in this day and age, you want to do something cool and show something in really slow motion. For example, you're throwing a stick to your dog and it jumps through the air and grabs the stick and it just looks really awesome. Or maybe your friend wasn't at their best behavior, so you just want to punch them, but you know, for maximum effect, you want to film that in slow motion and then show it to your other friends. I don't know your reasons, guys, but there's always that possibility. And believe me, it's really bad when you're looking over some cool footage that you were filming and you're like, man, this would look so good in slow-mo, but I filmed it in 24 frames per second. That reason speaks for itself. Reason number two is the aesthetic. Now, real slow-mo, or the way we're used to seeing in YouTube videos, is actually 120 frames per second, but only the newer cameras like the A7 III and the iPhones, they have 120 frames per second. And that's like really slow, like you can see things happening really slowly in time. Whereas 60 frames per second is what they call kind of natural slow motion. It does kind of slow down the action, but not enough for you to be like, wow, there's a little bit of saliva coming down their lip, because it kind of flows by naturally. Maybe you could describe it as though you're dreaming or have an extra level of perception of what's going on. So what it does to your footage is enhance it in different ways. For example, if you're filming a wedding or something romantic, it just makes it more romantic. Like that touch of a hand in slow motion, or that kiss, or that dance move, that embrace. I don't know, whatever you're shooting, but it makes it a little bit more romantic. Maybe you're filming someone doing some kind of hard labor or giving a speech, and all of those movements just look so much more dramatic. Like he's chopping wood. And it's like, ooh, instead of being like plack, 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 all of a sudden you're watching this, boom, the piece of wood flies off. Again, it's not like super slow-mo, you're like, when's he finally gonna cut that one piece of wood? But it's like, boom, the wood flies away. You see the muscles ripple across the skin. What am I saying? And that's especially cool for something really fast, like action sports. You know, you have a bike going and then you just use that tiny little bit of slow-mo to be like, and again, it's not like, when's that bike gonna fly over the sky? I'm waiting for ages, but it's kind of like a, I've been using this effect for such a long time, and I do have to admit I overuse it. Like, I have so many videos which are literally 60p slowed down the entire time. Like, literally, I slow down the entire timeline, cut out the clips I like, montage it together to some music, and the whole video is like, dramatic. And it's worked for me so far because that's something new, that's something people don't really see here, so people are like, whoa, that's cool, I want that. But I know that overusing is not cool and it's gonna get old really quickly. So what I really have to start doing more is speed ramping, where things are going real time or maybe even a little bit faster. And all of a sudden you go zoom into 60p and then you go back out into something fast. Number three is eliminating camera shake, or that jitter that you have without stabilization. Now, this was the first and main reason why I started shooting everything in 60p. Entry-level DSLRs don't have stabilization built into them, and neither does my favorite lens, which I use all the time for shooting. Which means that other than the warp stabilizer and editing, which sometimes make your footage look really ugly, I had no option but to shoot in 60p to stabilize some of that shake. Now, in case you don't know how that works, I'm gonna explain to you just a little bit. I mean, honestly, there's not much explaining to do. Like, if you're shaking this, it's really visible in the video. But if you slow it down to twice the speed or even more, because 60 frames per second taken down to 24 frames per second is 2.5 times, I believe. So this is a much smoother motion than this. Likewise, the jitter, which is kind of like, is kind of a little bit like this, and then you correct it with warp stabilizer and it looks okay. Don't overdo on the warp stabilizer. I do that all the time. I have to stop doing that. Don't overdo either. When you apply the warp stabilizer, there's a little percentage which is always at 50%, so you take it down to like 20%, 10%, 5%, and then it looks okay. Don't always keep it at 50%. Ilya, don't always keep it at 50%. Number four is having smoother movements. Now, that might kind of belong with number three, because like I said, instead of this movement, you get this movement. But now, instead of just talking talking about camera jitter, I'm talking about pans and movements. I don't really like standing in one position and shooting videos like this. I want to move around the subject, create something cool, move up and down, move in, rotate around something, and that's really hard if you don't have a gimbal, if you're on a budget like me and you don't have a gimbal. And getting those by hand without a stabilized camera is really hard. Like, you can be the stillest person on earth and your footage is still gonna be kind of like So when you shoot that real time, it kind of looks like this. But then when you slow it down, again, 2.5 times slower, it kind of looks like this. Again, you have the same amount of movement, but it's spread over a longer time, so it's not as noticeable. And when you throw in a slight warp stabilizer, it looks really smooth. And if you set up the shot right and the lighting is right and the warp doesn't screw up, some shots can look really amazing, like you took them on a slider or a gimbal. And people won't even know that you've taken it by hand without stabilization. And number 5 is having more content to choose from. Now, as a rule of thumb, I always like to shoot at least 3 times more footage than I know I'm gonna need in the end. I take all kinds of shots. I take 4 angles of every possible subject and thing I'm shooting, pretty much on the good days, just to make sure I have enough, because there's nothing worse when you want to make a 2-minute video but you realize you only have 1.5 minutes of good footage. And actually 60p turned down to 24p helps you a lot with that. It literally means that you have 2.5 times as much footage. Of course, this doesn't work for everything, but instead of having a pan shot that goes around for 1 second, you now have a pan shot that goes around for 2.5 seconds. And there are often times when you're shooting an event but there's nothing really happening, there's nothing to shoot, nothing to spark interest, but you have to make like a 2-minute or 3-minute video because of that. So instead of shooting a bunch of useless clips, you just slow some of them down and you get more footage. You stretch out the footage and you get a nice, long, interesting video. So those are the 5 reasons for shooting in 60p, but let's be fair and look a little bit at the drawbacks as well. There are very few drawbacks and they're not very significant, but it's worth touching on them just so you know. If you're shooting 60p, you have to shoot with a shutter speed of at least 1 over 60, and preferably, according to the shutter angle thing, you should be shooting at 1 over 125. That means you're losing a good amount of light as opposed to shooting in 1 over 25 or 1 over 50, which is what you would do if you were shooting 24p. That could be a deal breaker if you're in a dark area and you don't have a prime with a really wide aperture, so that's really something you have to consider. In the past, when I didn't have good sensors or good lenses, I actually had to switch back to 24p just to get more light because it was dark and I had no other way of getting usable footage. Of course, there are other little problems, like if you're shooting at 60p, you're gonna have a file that's 2.5 times as big as otherwise, so you're gonna need a bigger SD card, and then also it's writing the video a lot faster, so you need higher writing speeds on the SD card. And then editing 60p on your computer is gonna be way slower because the computer needs a lot more editing power. Although if you bring it down to 24p, it pretty much treats it like normal footage. And that's the end of my introduction to 60p. I think this world is still in a good stage for 60p because phones are entering to the market now. A lot of phones have 60p built into them, so people are using their phones for vlogging and editing, so it's a good piece of information to have. Thank you guys for watching. As always, I hope you learned something. Remember to give me the feedback on the intro. I really wanna up this vlog game as much as I can for this year and really put a lot of effort into every vlog, more than I did last year. Again, thank you for watching, and as always, I'm gonna see you guys next week. I didn't think of what I would do for an ending for my vlog. Maybe I should change this whole Patreon, make it something visually like kapow, flying out at you like explosion, and people like, I want to be your patron too. Have to think about that.